கொரோனா தொற்று பரவல் குறித்த நடவடிக்கைகள் குறித்து விளக்குவதற்காக மத்திய சுகாதாரத்துறையின் இணை செயலாளர் செய்தியாளர்களை சந்தித்து வருகிறார். அதனை நேரலையில் பார்க்கலாம்.
And the next three issues which I'm going to talk about are about bringing down the wave, dealing with future ones. The three points are, what can we do, what does the virus do, and what do vaccines do? What we can and should do is simply stated, but not easy to implement, as we have seen. Yet the best time for us to change our behavior is now. What we at every level, from individuals, families, communities, local government, state government, central government, need to do is to maximally and effectively maintain distance and follow COVID appropriate behavior. This is critically important. Distancing can exponentially bring down the spread. The virus can only go from human to human. In each context, therefore, we need to follow COVID appropriate behavior that is most effective and tailor it to that context. Now, I'll be principally giving an overview on the other points. What does the virus do and what vaccines and science can do in that context? I will briefly summarize how SARS coronavirus 2 variants emerge and what they mean for us and what they mean for us going ahead. Dr. Sujit Singh, Director NCDC, and Dr. Renu Swarup, Secretary Department of Biotechnology, will elaborate on the variants under investigation and of concern in India. Let me just summarize the key conclusions before I go on. First, we need to do what we need to do does not change because of the variants. Masks and distancing are critical and most effective. Given the higher transmissibility of some variants, this is most important, but it is the same message. The variants do not alter the message. The variants are transmitted the same way as the original strain. It does not have other properties of new kinds of transmission in the air or anything like that. It just infects humans in a manner which makes it more transmissible because it gains entry, makes more copies, and goes out again, the same way as the original one. Second, vaccines are effective against the current variants. Third, new variants will arise all over the world and in India too. While variants which increase transmission will likely plateau, immune evasive variants and those which lower or increase disease severity will arise going ahead. Finally, scientists in India and all over the world are working to anticipate these kinds of variants and act against them rapidly by early warning and developing modified tools. This is an intense research program which is happening in India and abroad. Now let us look at variants and the huge second wave. Many factors contributed to this large wave, and variants are but one factor. Now, why did the first wave decline? Let us understand that first. And why did the second wave start? Why is it so severe? You've heard from Dr. Lav Agarwal what we're doing and what we should do about what is happening now. But the first wave declined because of two factors. As infections rose, so did immunity amongst those infected. As cautionary steps at every one of these levels I alluded to earlier, from individual to high level, increased, there was less opportunity for infections to spread. A combination of a standing level of immunity in the population and cautionary steps halted this spread of the first wave and caused a decline. Unless new opportunities arise, this would have been the situation. New opportunities came about all over the world and in India too. If cautionary steps decline, new opportunities for spread arise. What happens if we drop our guard? The level of caution drops, but also so does the standing level of immunity is often not enough to stop infection spreading. Many people get infected until we reach a new immunity threshold. Such a second wave is typically smaller than the first. Such a second wave was expected. However, multiple parameters can change in small amounts and add up to a second wave much larger than the first. Each parameter may seem a small change, but together, because the rise is exponential, this adds up enormously. Such a much larger second wave with the ferocity we are seeing was not predicted. But what contributes to a large second wave? What were the opportunities open to the virus? After a first wave, immunity can keep new infections low. However, immunity may not have been widespread, and the fraction uninfected due to cautionary steps they have taken in the first wave may have been large. Immunity can also fade. Someone who has recovered could be reinfected, but we know that after 8 months of being infected, protection is still very high. It's about 80%. But could that 20% be sufficient to cause immune evasion of significance? So the combination of less caution, less immunity in a population from the first wave, and the consequent opening up of access to the virus drives a large second wave. In other words, as long as variants are not immune evasive substantially, their being more transmissible is important, but that alone will not cause a big surge unless cautionary steps decline and a large population is available for infection. What role do the variants play in the size of the second wave? Let us look at that. And to do that, we have to see how SARS coronavirus 2 was successful so quickly. This virus emerged in late 2019 in Wuhan, and at that time, it was a virus which we could call a generalist. It could infect many mammal species, minks, cats, dogs, etc. And it indicates that it's not specifically a tightly human-adapted virus. Now, this didn't change much in all of 2020, and all the evolutionary signals show evidence for this lineage to continue in the same way. The first 11 months of the SARS coronavirus 2 evolution had a relatively low accumulation, slow accumulation of mutations, about 2 mutations per month in global lineages. Generally, not much of what is called adaptive evolution.